Hola, y'all. Happy Tuesday. I got the furniture today. That's nice. I don't have to walk around a couch and a lift seat anymore. Dogs haven't barked all night, and yet I walk outside and there they go. But that's okay. Mom, I'm gonna ignore them. You ever been disillusioned? If you don't know or if you don't remember what that means, disillusioned is how you feel when you discover that something is not as good as you thought it was. In other words, you uncover the truth behind something, whatever that is, whether that's a person or that's a situation. Whatever it is, it gave off the appearance that it was okay. And then upon further inspection, you realize, oh, it's not what I thought. The feeling that you have after realizing that is disillusionment. You're disillusioned. It's a mini deception or a great deception. I don't know. I guess it's according to how invested you were in that thing or that person or that situation, how deeply you were convinced of its authenticity or goodness. That would probably determine the level of your disillusionment. It's a strange feeling. It's a strange place to be in. It feels like shifting sand because you have to rethink. You don't just rethink what you thought something was. You go back and you rehave all the conversations about that situation that you had previously. Or you go back and you relive all the experiences that you had with that person previously. Or you go back and you remember everything that you thought you knew. And you go back and you relive those experiences through your new lens. And it can be deeply unsettling. It can cause the ground beneath you to shift in a way that can leave you. It is the only emotion that I think of, like, just sitting down and literally just staring into space, into the abyss, into just blank space, just staring forward with wide eyes. And other than that, really no expression whatsoever, in incredible disbelief, coupled with almost crippling disappointment. And you just sit there and you go, how, why, when, what, where? And I think you sit there for a while in that stupor, that disillusioned stupor, until your mind finds a way to rationalize whatever it is that you've just been slammed with. And you rationalize it. That's how we deal with things. So you find a reason, or you find an excuse, or you find out why. I mean, you find the real reason why. And then you have to come to terms with it. And you get up out of your stupor a different person than when you sat back down. I know this sounds weird. I know you're going, what is she talking about today? You know, the Bible talks about false prophets. It even tells you how to spot them. You know, we hear prophets and we think of, you know, some giant spiritual figure in the church. But I would venture to say anyone in the church who is living a double lifestyle is a false prophet. You don't have to have a minister's license and you don't have to have a pulpit to be a false prophet. You just have to be leading people away from the truth. So I was looking up some scriptures on that. And there's a lot of ways you can spot one. One of them, it says they make predictions and they don't come to pass. And in the Old Testament, that was definitely a mark of a false prophet, was someone who said this is going to happen and their word didn't come to pass, which showed that the Lord had never revealed that to them and did not tell them that. And really the only motivation, there's probably several motivations, but the ones that stand out to me, why someone would be so inclined to pretend to hear from God and to give out information like that is to become popular, to become more lucrative. I mean, you can sell books on some of that stuff, or you can be asked to speak. You can be asked your opinion. You can be asked to write, you know, just lots of, it can be lucrative. It's greed, but sometimes you just want to feel important. You just want to look important. Prestige, pride. You want to be famous. You want your name in lights. And even back in the Old Testament, the same things that we battle today, they battled back then too. The weapons just look a little bit differently. The artillery, the utensils we use are just a little bit different, but the spirits are all the same. So that's why they're driven to do some of those things. But the New Testament tells us that beware of a different type of false prophet. Some of them, by the way, can do signs, miracles, and wonders. Yeah. So you might say, well, I would be able to identify someone who's not really spiritually in line with God because they wouldn't be able to do miracles. But that's not biblical, because even the Antichrist and those who are not associated with God and on the right side of things, he says, are able to perform miraculous things. So if you're looking for a miracle or a sign, you could be deceived. God is way bigger than miracles, signs, and wonders. Matter of fact, to even think that that's all he is, dumbs, it just cheapens him to a point that's very frustrating to me. It's not even the best part about him. The best part about God, his forgiveness and salvation, that's the thing right there. Because we're all appointed to die down here. So I don't have to be healed. If he wants to heal me, if I'm sick, please do. But I don't have to be healed. I need to be saved. I need to be forgiven and washed in his blood. Okay? So no, the miracles and signs and wonders don't sum up who God is. They're not the best thing he's ever done. They're not the most important thing that he does. The most important thing he ever did was go to a cross, receive stripes for my healing if he so chooses, and died. He paid the price so that I don't have to die for my sins and burn forever in a place that I don't want to be at. That's the greatest thing he did for us. Now, I know it may not be all glittery and gold like miracle signs and wonders. It's brutal and sad. Now, resurrection is happy, but the death is a brutal one. But that's why we're here today. And I'm not going to skimp over it. I'm not going to sugarcoat it. And I'm definitely not just going to talk to people about miracle signs and wonders, because even false prophets can do those. So if that's all we're hanging our spiritual attunement on, watch out, because somebody's going to be deceived in the end time. We already know it. So get in the word. And don't just seek a sign, because Jesus even said, this generation seeks signs, but that's not what he came to do. So I'm off of that, but that goes along with a false prophet. Okay. So we know that they can do that, but you know how else you can tell? False prophets' lifestyles and teachings take you away from biblical principles. That's your number one right there. Check it against God's word. And more importantly, more than what people say, look at what they do. Way more important, not what they say. Look at what they do. Or you may find yourself sitting somewhere one day disillusioned because you bought into the lie that someone was actually doing what was coming out of their mouth. And you found them living an alternate lifestyle. I heard a quote. It's a super old quote, guys. Matter of fact, I might play it at the end of the video. I don't know. I'll just say it. Oh, how does it go? The number one thing that people who don't believe in God find unbelievable are Christians that acknowledge God with their mouth and deny him by their lifestyle. That is what an unbelieving world finds unbelievable. Do you know who slapped with disillusionment too? People who are looking at people who say they love God and they're wanting it to be true. And they're watching to see if you're different and if I'm different. And they're watching to see if what comes out of our mouth lines up with what we do on Saturday nights and Sunday mornings. And does it match up on Tuesday afternoons? Does it match up when we're on vacation? Does it match up when we're in Vegas? You know that phrase, what happens in Vegas stays in Vegas. Well, whatever you're doing in Vegas, I hate to tell you, but God's also in Vegas. Make it make sense. Make it make sense. They're disillusioned by Christians who don't stand for Christian values. They're disillusioned by Christians who say one thing and go do something else. They're disillusioned by Christians. Who behave in ways that are anti-biblical. And no, I'm not just talking about your personal convictions here. They observe Christians who break the Ten Commandments repeatedly. And wear what would Jesus do? Bracelets and t-shirts and... disillusion. I actually wasn't going to talk about that. I was just going to talk about a little bit of false prophets, and I was just going to talk about the shock. And I have God to help me deal with disillusionment when something just takes me smooth off my feet. And it's happened in life before, for sure. For sure. And you step back and you reevaluate and you say, okay, let me find the truth. Let me realign myself with the truth. Let me stand on the side of truth. And let's start again. And let's see if we can start again. Realign, reset, reevaluate. Repent if you're on the wrong side of the disillusionment. There is always a place of repentance for us if we were living a double life, if we were deceiving other people. There's forgiveness if we make a mistake. And, you know, no matter how far you go down a path, I was talking with someone the other day, no matter how far you go down a path, you can always turn around. There's always hope. You can turn around. Will there be consequences? Maybe, probably, but that's okay. Just turn around and deal with them. You can do it. It's much better than going down the wrong road even further. Something on the tip of my tongue and it just flew right out of my head. Disillusionment. Oh yeah, here it is. I'm gonna finish with this. Jesus said, not everybody who says to me, Lord, will enter into the kingdom of heaven. There's even another place. I'm gonna come back to that. There's also another place that says, they profess to know me, but they deny the power. I don't know what you think, but I mean, when I read especially the New Testament, but all over, when I see power, we're endued with power from on high, baptism with Holy Ghost fire and with power. The Holy Ghost is our power. He said, beware of people who deny the power thereof. But go back to the other one. Not everybody on that day who says to me, Lord, Lord, is going to enter into the kingdom of heaven. Do you know what that tells me? There's going to be people that have done this so long, that have deceived other people and themselves so long, that they actually are going to show up on judgment day and call Jesus Lord. And he's going to say, I don't even know who you are. But they're going to show up believing that they're about to walk into heaven. How deceived do you have to be? I've asked people before. I have to end. I'm trying not to go long, Mom. I have to end. But there are times when you look at people and you say, do they believe the lies that are actually coming out of their mouth? Or are they just lying for you know, to gain something? But I don't know. I'm serious, you guys. When I say I have seen people that will hold on to that lie, they will die with that lie. And so it begs the question, have they lied so long that they have convinced themselves that it is the truth? And that's why they're willing to fall on that sword? It's got to be something. And the Bible talks about in the end time, people will be deceived. Means tricked. You will be tricked, or I will be tricked, if we don't stay diligent into believing a lie. Okay? So I'm telling you tonight to be on your P's and Q's. And as much as you want to believe the best about people, and I think you should, you also have to be aware of the entire Word of God, who says there are those among you that are in sheep's clothing, and they look innocent, and they look like they're wanting to do good, and they look like they're right. But it said on the inside, they are ravenous wolves, and they are devouring people spiritually. They are leading people astray, and they are leading second lifestyles in the dark. And from such, turn away. Happy Tuesday. Stay strong. Stay vigilant. Stay diligent. But more importantly, guys, stay truthful and stay real and honest and godly. See you tomorrow.
The greatest single cause of atheism in the world today is Christians who acknowledge Jesus with their lips and walk out the door and deny him by their lifestyle. That is what an unbelieving world simply finds unbelievable.
This one for the Lord, or do I simply serenade?